Right now on Colorado Point of View, it couldn't be any closer. The race for Colorado's new congressional district is one of the most heated and most important in the nation. Right now, two Colorado lawmakers are hoping to go from the state capitol to the U.S. Capitol. We've heard Republican Barb Kirkmeyer's Colorado Point of View on the issues.
I have proven that I listen to people and then come in and find real solutions.
Now, hear from her opponent, Democratic State Representative Dr. Yadira Caraveo. Plus,
Senator Bennett votes 98% with Biden.
Senate Republicans are pouring cash into Colorado. Our political analyst on why the GOP is targeting Senator Michael Bennett. That and more right here, right now on Colorado Point of View. I'm Matt Morrow, and this is Colorado Point of View. We are now less than 100 days away from the November midterm elections. And right now, once again, we are focusing on a race that both parties are watching very closely. This, what you see in purple, the 8th Congressional District, the new one here in Colorado. It covers Commerce City, North Glen, Thornton, Greeley, and many rural areas in northern Colorado as well. And right now, these two state lawmakers, Democratic State Representative Dr. Yadira Caraveo and Republican State Senator Barb Kirkmeyer, are facing off this November for the seat. And you can see right here from some of these election forecasters, they are calling this a race, a toss-up, or giving Kirkmeyer, the Republican, the edge. In case you missed it last Sunday, here are the issues Kirkmeyer told me she would focus on if she's elected.
The issues that are pressing this district are about inflation. They're about the rising crime rate. I mean, we're at a 40-year high on inflation. Mm-hmm. We are at a 25-year high on crime rate in this country. Those are the issues. We need to secure our border. Those are the issues, not the extreme issues and the poor Democrat policies that have been being passed by my opponent.
Now it's time for the Democrat to give her Colorado point of view on the issues affecting you the most. Joining me this morning, State Representative and Dr. Yadira Caraveo. Dr. Caraveo, thanks for being here. I appreciate it very much.
Thank you so much for having me this morning.
As we just saw, by all accounts, this is one of the most competitive, the most heated, and the most important House races in the country. And it appears, by looking at a couple of these election forecasts, your opponent, Barb Kirkmeyer, the Republican, has the edge. Two reliable election sites right here say they lean or tilt to the Republican side. So how do you change the tide here and win over unaffiliated voters who we all know really make the difference in most elections in Colorado?
You're absolutely right. 46% of this district is made up of unaffiliated voters who really have to go out and give the message of what the differences are between myself and my opponent. I was born and raised in Colorado. I grew up in this district and have a lot of ties ranging from North Glen and Thornton, where I grew up, all the way up to the more rural areas where my uncles were agricultural workers. And so I intend to go out and talk to the people about everything that I've been hearing in clinic for the last 10 years. Those are the reasons that I decided to run for office in this district. And I think that once we make that connection and talk about how extreme my opponent is, that those numbers will be changing.
All right, we talk about numbers. Let's talk about one of the biggest issues in this race in the nation right now, the numbers dealing with inflation and rising prices. If you're elected to Congress, what can you specifically do to help bring these prices down and to save Americans money?
You know, I think the biggest thing that we need to do is to elect people who understand these issues firsthand. I grew up in a family where my dad was a construction worker. He was able to put four kids through college on just that one salary so that my mom could stay home and raise us. And so I saw them have the same conversations at kitchen tables that I know that the families that I see in clinic are having. Far too many people are able to self-fund campaigns and come into Congress with a lot of money. That's not me. That's not who I am. That's not what this community is. And so I think first and foremost, we need to elect people who are reflective of their community, who will understand the needs of the middle class.
You could put those people in Congress, but what can you do to bring the prices down? I mean, that is the specific question. That's the one issue that is affecting every single American right now.
You know, I think for starters, we have to address a lot of the tax loopholes the corporations take advantage of every day. We have a Congress who has placed their needs above the middle class that makes up a lot of the 8th district. We also have to take into account that, a lot of the work that we've done in Colorado is work that has to happen at the federal level with extending the early tax credit for children, with making sure that we are putting money back in the pockets of everyday working Americans like we are doing with with the early release of the TABOR funds and making sure that we decrease the cost of medical care and prescription drugs, all of which I have worked on at the state legislature.
Okay, let's talk about TABOR right now. It has become an issue in Colorado and in a lot of the races right here. A little while ago, you wrote, this is a quote from your website when you were running for the state house, and you said, "Funding is key to addressing most of the issues we have in Colorado, and without the elimination of TABOR, funding in the state will always fall short of our needs." And in 2019, you co-sponsored a bill that went to voters that, if they had chosen to, would have eventually eliminated the TABOR refunds here in the state. This year, you praised the TABOR refunds, that the governor and the legislature were on board on it. So which is it, TABOR or no TABOR, the refunds or the state keeping the money? Because you can't really have it both ways.
You know, TABOR is what we have. The voters have spoken on this issue. I have seen firsthand as a legislature, in the legislature, how it limits our ability to fully fund education and take care of our infrastructure needs in the state. But it is what the law is. And so what we made sure to do as Democrats is to give that money back early, to give it in a way that is more fair to taxpayers, so that those of us who have the lower incomes have the largest refunds from TABOR, and that we're giving it at a time when people really need money in their pockets.
Why not do that in the past? Many would ask, why do it just in a close election year?
I think the distinguishing feature of this year is not just that it's an election year. It's that it's inflation is really affecting people. And so we decided to do this to make sure that we're getting money back for people who are spending a lot of extra money at the gas pump and at the grocery store.
So if you had your way, would TABOR stay in Colorado, or would you prefer to get rid of it and therefore the state be able to spend extra money and people would not get the refund?
You know, I think that we absolutely need to take care of some of the funding issues that we have in Colorado to make sure that we're properly funding schools. That's one of the reasons that I ran, is I was seeing some of the shortfalls that schools were having with the children that I see in clinic every day. Not like when they were properly funded back when I was in school and were able to prepare me for a private college and medical school. So there's a lot of issues that need to be fixed with funding at the state level.
Last question here on money. Republicans are criticizing you right now for basically voting to take away money from working families, increase fees or taxes, whatever you want to call them. This is what the governor called the Fix Our Damn Roads bill, raise the gas taxes, put fees on the taxes on deliveries, Amazon, ride shares, etc. How does that go along with the idea of saving people money, especially right now at a really hard time?
You know, I think that the Republicans are actually focusing on things that are convenient for them right now and not looking at all of the tax credits and breaks that we've given to the middle class. They're not looking at the fact that they didn't support child tax credits, that they haven't supported a lot of the policies that we know are going to lower costs for American and Colorado families at their grocery store, at the gas pump, and at the doctor's office. And so they're only focusing on things that are convenient for them.
All right, another issue that you're focusing on, Democrats are focusing on, everybody is right now, is crime. Take a look at a tweet that came out this week from the Adams County Sheriff's Office. It says, since January, there have been 744 reports of stolen vehicles just in that county. I had our data desk take a look at motor vehicle thefts in Thornton, an area we represent. In 2020 and 2021, you can see the stats on the bar graph right here, car thefts surged, and this year, there are already more stolen vehicles than there were in all of 2019. And property crime was at its highest levels in 2020 and 2021 in Thornton. And this is what your opponent, Ms. Kirkmeyer, said about this last week. Listen.
My opponent, again, as a Democrat, has been there coddling criminals for the last 4 years with Democrat policies and passing legislation that helps out criminals instead of looking at the victims.
How do you respond to her, and how do you respond to the rise in crime in the districts, in the areas where you live and where you represent, in the areas you want to represent in Congress?
You know, I think what she said is just not true. I supported bipartisan legislation this year to hold criminals accountable and make sure that we're helping communities that need help. And that is what I have focused on my entire legislative career.
You did vote for the bill in 2019 to reduce the penalties for fentanyl and other hard drug use with 4 grams or more. Some say that led to a spike in fentanyl overdoses here in Colorado. Looking back on that, do you regret that vote?
You know, I think that what I am focused on is that this year I voted on a bipartisan bill to make sure that we're treating criminals like criminals, that we're providing help for our community. I've seen the effects of substance abuse issues with the families that I see in clinic every day. And we are making very large investments to make sure that we're taking care of people before and during addiction.
All right, quickly, let's touch on some of the big social issues that we know could very well affect and influence voters coming up in the midterms right here. Abortion. Where do you stand on a woman having the right to an abortion?
I am absolutely in favor of women having a choice of what to do with their own bodies. As a healthcare worker, I have had those conversations in clinic, in private, which is where they should stay. The Republican Party, and my opponent is an extreme Republican, is really hell-bent on taking that right away. They do not trust women to make their own decisions with their body. I will always, always support a woman's right to choose.
With no restriction at all.
I think that that is something that somebody has to have a conversation between their family, their person who they trust with their faith, and their doctor.
Quickly, same-sex marriage. The House recently voted to create a law to guarantee that right nationwide. Would you support that if you're elected?
Absolutely. This is another extreme measure that my opponent would want to take. She has spoken about taking away the right to marriage for same-sex couples in Colorado, something that is not in keeping with the majority of Coloradans or Americans.
And lastly here, gun rights versus gun control. There's been a lot of talk about that. Do you support increasing red flag laws? Do you think that the Second Amendment means more people should be able to get guns and there shouldn't be a restriction? Where do you stand on this?
I think what we've done in Colorado is a great measure of what the federal government needs to do and what other states need to do, taking into account that we, you know, my parents, I grew up around guns with my dad and my brother hunting, but there is ways to be responsible about gun ownership and make sure that we are not letting guns get into the hands of people who are mentally ill or who have shown a history of violence.
There have been votes in Congress recently on an assault weapons ban. Would you support that?
You know, I think that people who are under 21 absolutely should not have access to assault weapons. We have seen time and time again 18-year-old young men who have a history of violence or issues get their hands on these guns, and we need to restrict their ability to do that.
Over 21, no restriction, though, on an assault weapon?
I think for now I'm focusing on the 18 to 21 range.
All right. Dr. Yadira Caraveo, state rep as well, a candidate for Colorado's 8th Congressional District. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate your time very much.
Thank you so much, Matt.
And a reminder, you can hear everything Dr. Caraveo's opponent had to say on these issues anytime. My interview with State Senator Barb Kirkmeyer is on our website. You'll be able to see the full interview with Dr. Caraveo as well, along with all episodes of Colorado Point of View. Well, Democrats seeing a glimmer of hope this November after a big win for abortion rights this week. Our analyst on if this could slow down what many see as a red wave coming up in the midterm. Stay there.
With Biden and the D.C. politicians in charge, gas prices more than doubled. Senator Bennett votes 98% with Biden. He just goes along.
Groceries, housing. All right, more cash is on the way to Colorado in the form of the U.S. Senate race. The National Republican Senatorial Committee just spent $250,000, $250,000 this week for this ad that tries to tie Senator Michael Bennett to President Biden, whose approval ratings continue to be extremely low. Bennett's campaign, for its part, says the ad misinforms voters. And for the senator's part, he continues to spend part of his massive pile of campaign cash, releasing a second ad that you see right here, touting his support from unaffiliated voters. This airs in Denver and Colorado Springs at a cost of some $600,000. Let's take a closer look at what this all means with these two gentlemen, Democratic strategist, presidential and gubernatorial advisor, senior advisor Andy Boyan, and Michael Fields, Republican strategist and the head of the Advanced Colorado Institute. Gentlemen, thanks for being here. It's
good
to see you. 2 years ago, this probably sounds familiar, Democrats had huge success here in Colorado by tying then-Senator Cory Gardner to then-President Donald Trump. John Hickenlooper ended up winning that race by 10 points. Andy, it's now the opposite. Republicans are tying Bennett to Joe Biden. Is this going to make the Democrats sweat here?
You know, I think this is going to be somewhat of a competitive U.S. Senate race. I think ultimately we're going to come out on top. But one of the things that's interesting about this race versus 20 is that we have a little bit different situation that Trump was really sort of an almost isolative president by this time in 20, where Biden is out talking. He's engaging. He might have some gaffes here and there, but at the end of the day, gas prices are down for the 52nd day in a row. People are paying less at the grocery store than they were 30 days ago. So we're working in the best way we can to calm this. And in addition to that, Senator Bennett has a solid record since 2010. of a very proactive senator, including and not limited to all kinds of things regarding foreign and domestic policy. So a lot to say here, but the tying of the two, while it's a political campaign tactic that worked in 20, I don't think it'll be as successful this year.
You talk about the senator's record. I just checked on the website 538, which tracks votes. It does say that Senator Bennett has voted with President Biden 98% of the time. That is fact. That is on there. Michael, do you see an ad like this narrowing the race here in Colorado?
I think that's the tactic you have to take, given the approval ratings are so low for Joe Biden, negative 20 here in Colorado. You have to tie Senator Bennett to him. And, you know, he's spending money right now, Senator Bennett is, but it doesn't seem like he's taking it that seriously. These ads that he has, he's fishing, he's hiking, he's hanging out. If I were him and I had only passed one bill over 13 years, I'd probably be taping me sitting at the desk trying to figure out how to fix inflation. I think, you know, this is going to be a closer race. You're seeing national interests like the NRSC coming in and doing it. And you have other states, like Pennsylvania and Ohio that are becoming more, you know, competitive. And so you have an open map, and Colorado is going to be on that map.
When you talk about Pennsylvania and maybe a reason why the NRSC is spending money here in Colorado right now, you see a lot of reports that Dr. Oz in Pennsylvania, the Republican senatorial candidate, is in trouble. Herschel Walker, former football star, may be in trouble in Georgia. So why would they take money out of those races potentially and bring it here to a race that doesn't seem nearly as close as some of those?
I got to just say that, you know, I think the Republican Party sees Colorado, while Mitch McConnell says competitive, I really don't think they see it as that competitive. And I really think they're going to spend some more money here, but I think they're going to see Bennett win this race. O'Day's not raising any money. He's counting on natural Republicans to raise it for him. He's somewhat of a lazy candidate, hasn't come out much and done much fundraising, nor really spoken on any major issues recently. So I don't think they see it as close.
Michael, are Republicans concerned about some of these other states and they're trying to, say, put their money somewhere else to try to win control of the Senate? But
I think one of it is that fundraising is so good for Mitch McConnell's PAC and the NRSC that they have hundreds of millions of dollars to spend in these races. And so you're going to see a ton of money go into Georgia and Pennsylvania, races that were closer in 2020. But I think they're going to expand the map. And you have to look at Arizona. You have to look at Nevada. Here in Colorado, New Hampshire is going to be another one. So I think the Republicans have enough money to broaden that map, make Democrats be defensive in all these races.
Okay, now to a surprising outcome in a primary election this week that is giving Democrats a little more hope come this November. In neighboring Kansas, which is a Republican stronghold, voters overwhelmingly rejected a plan that would have allowed state lawmakers to restrict or ban abortion. You see the votes right here, 59-41. On top of that, there is finally some good economic news coming a little bit. Gas prices are dropping, according to AAA, as of Thursday, the national average. Now at $4.16 a gallon in Colorado, it is more, $4.33 a gallon. Michael, in a close race like Colorado's 8th District, which we focused on for a couple of weeks right here, when you look at how Kansas voted on this abortion issue, does that give Republicans some concern here in Colorado and across the country?
I don't think it gives concern in Colorado, given the fact that nothing changes after Roe decision here in Colorado, that you still have abortion available here. You know, people's views on this are very complex. You know, if you pass something that says, you know, 15 week or more ban, that's very popular. So I don't know how much of an impact it has on like the 8th congressional district, for example. I think the economic issues have a much more impact. And you look at those gas prices. Yeah, sure, they've gone down some, but they started at $2.38. This is still at $4.33, crushing Coloradans, and especially in the 8th district.
But real quickly, the issue of abortion and how voters in Kansas, a very red state, yes, voted on this. What does that mean for the national picture, particularly in the U.S. House?
It shows obviously that Kansas voters are more in touch with reality than the National Republican Party. And I think what happened last night was the Republican Party opened their eyes to the fact that they might be completely out of touch with social issues, and Kansas isn't.
No, I think what it shows is that this is the process that should have been happening from the start, that Roe made it so that states decide. States can make the decision. You can come up with another ballot issue. You can go to the legislature and talk about it. But this is where people are actually weighing in on it. And so, you know, whether you like the outcome or not, I think the process is better than what we've had.
All right. Michael Fields, Andy Boyan. Gentlemen, good to see you as always. I appreciate it. Up next, magic mushrooms. Yeah, they're on the ballot here in Colorado. We'll break down two measures you'll vote on this November. We are back here on Colorado Point of View. Take a look here. Magic mushrooms. Yeah, magic mushrooms. You heard that right. They're going to be on the ballot this November. You'll get to decide if you want Colorado to remove the criminal penalties for them. Gabrielle Franklin explains.
Colorado was the first to legalize cannabis, recreational adult use licensing. But if you look at who owns all the licensing, you know, it's very inequitable here. Social equity was an afterthought.
Melanie Rose Rogers is a co-proponent of Initiative 61. The initiative calls to decriminalize the possession, cultivation, giving away, and sharing of entheogenic plants and fungi.
We believe that no one should go to jail for the use and possession of these substances.
Initiative 58, the one that's officially on the ballot, calls for what's commonly referred to as magic mushrooms to be sold from healing centers regulated by DORA. The centers would be run by trained facilitators who are at least 21 and able to guide users through the process. Users wouldn't be able to leave the centers until the effects of the mushrooms wore off. People previously arrested for possession of the drugs could file a petition with the courts to have those records sealed if this passes. But Initiative 61 supporters worry the language of Initiative 58 sets up a pathway for corporations to profit off users and did not include enough stakeholders of color.
Let's remove criminal penalties of these substances and then, you know, get all the right folks in the room, make sure there's definitely people of color, there's indigenous folks, legacy stewards and keepers of these medicines at the table.
Natural Medicine Colorado is backing Initiative 58. They tell us Colorado advocates have been collaborating on the Natural Medicine Health Act for more than a year now, and the final policy incorporated ideas and priorities from the many people and organizations who participated, including indigenous people and people of color. We continue to have an open door for anyone who has questions about the initiative or wants to join our coalition, because we know that will make the program stronger in the future, too. The deadline to collect enough signatures to get Initiative 61 on the ballot is coming up on August 8th. Supporters say if they aren't able to do that, they do plan to educate the community about the potential impacts of passing Initiative 58. In Denver, Gabrielle Franklin, Colorado Point of View.
Also today, the battle between Congresswoman Lauren Boebert and a group looking to dig up dirt on her continues. Jocelyn Stafford has more from Grand Junction in this week's Rocky Mountain Roundup.
Tensions rise between Congresswoman Lauren Boebert and a political action group as she takes one member to court. Boebert was granted a temporary protection order against David Wheeler on June 23rd until a full court hearing could be held. The defendant is known as the co-founder of the American Muckrakers Political Actions Committee, a group that says it's dedicated to ensuring Lauren Boebert's first term in office is her last. But the order was never served to Wheeler. According to one source, he left the state for North Carolina before they could give it to him. Nearly a month later, the Garfield County Court held a hearing to address Boebert's request for a permanent restraining order. On July 20th, Judge Paul Metzger rejected her request. The case was closed the same day. Jocelyn Stafford, Colorado Point of View.
Thank you for watching us. My thanks to State Rep Yadira Caraveo as well. And as always, to Andy and Michael. We'll see you next Sunday. Have a great week.